Before we introduce Dr. Johnson Robertson and invite him up here for the talk, we wanted to briefly introduce the Robotics Institute Summer Scholar Program. The RIST program each year consists of approximately 50 scholars, all of whom are in the room with us today. Every scholar is matched with a lab and a mentor that will guide them through the summer research process, and at the end of the summer, will publish a paper in the RIST Working Paper Journal. RIST for me has been an opportunity to immerse myself in cutting-edge research and be surrounded by mentors and peers who are as passionate about research as I am. Coming into the RIST program last year, I had never done a research project where I'm taking the lead from start to finish. From the beginning, my mentor helped me formulate a research question, and at each step, RIST provided me with a support system that allowed me to successfully complete a paper in the working journal. RIST is also much more than a research experience, but a community of researchers that support each other and are passionate about robotics. In my time at RIST, I formed connections and unforgettable memories with scholars from all over the world.
Now, without further ado, I'm excited to welcome and introduce Dr. Johnson Robertson as our speaker today. Dr. Johnson Robertson is the current director of the Robotics Institute here at Carnegie Mellon, earned his undergraduate degree at CMU in computer science and went to University of Sydney for his PhD. Previously, he was a member of the Deep Robot Optical Perception Lab at the University of Michigan, where he researched 3D reconstruction, segmentation, data mining, and visualization with a research goal of developing robotic systems capable of operating in complex dynamic environments. Some of his research includes path planning for autonomous underwater vehicles, as well as pedestrian trajectory predictions. Along with his many publications, he is the recipient of the 2015 NSF Career Award. Dr. Johnson Robertson, thank you for speaking with us today. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Amazing. Okay, so I call this sort of lessons from the field. I'm going to try to touch on a bunch of the different projects, probably in less technical detail than maybe I would otherwise, but I kind of want to cover the breadth and more of the exploratory, exciting sort of science angle of what I do, and less of the grindy deep learning part of it, which I think is less interesting. So when I got in robotics, you know, I think really the notion of what got me excited was this notion of like, we are trying to build some part of the future. And robots seem central to that vision of the future. And so for me, I think it was part of being excited about trying to develop something that didn't exist right now in this really sort of explorer sense of the future that got me excited doing robotics. And so I've gotten to work on a number of different robotic systems, sort of more recently in the last 5 or 7 years, I've been doing a lot around underwater robots that are interested in 3D mapping and exploration of sort of deep water marine environments. So these are the kind of typical AUVs that I was building in Michigan before I was here. And so these are designed to do optical mapping of the ocean floor. So the big applications for this are marine archaeology and environmental monitoring. And so I'll talk about a marine archaeology project. So this is a city in the southern bit of Greece, so just the southern bit of the Peloponnese. And it's a city that submerged in the Bronze Age due to kind of tectonic plate shifts. And it was mapped actually back, it was discovered and mapped back in 1968 pretty extensively by marine archaeologists. But the way they did that is diving masks, diving gear, and surveying poles. And so the sort of notion of this project, well, can we update that? And can we use sort of the technology that's advanced in robotics to build systems to kind of map and survey those environments in such a way that we can produce sort of these metrically accurate, sort of like very high resolution maps of those environments, but using robotic technology. So we went over 2 different years. And I guess one of the things that, one of the reasons I like this project is sort of the capturing of what I think is exciting about field robotics, to be specific, is we got to live in this sort of small resort town in southern Greece, spend every day right next to the beach, deploying the robot, having a break, having nothing go work properly at all, but at the end of it, try to gather enough data to do something interesting and cool. So that sort of field deployment produced 200,000 stereo pairs. And then we turn those 200,000 stereo pairs into this large scale reconstruction you see down there. And I think what's interesting about this, or why I think it's, you know, something that's unique, is that, you know, the resolution we're able to get, that's half a meter down there, we're able to see kind of each individual stone, but over this huge extent, right? So that line is not showing up properly, but that from here to here is 50 meters. And so covering this massive area, you can see here, and getting that all in really, really, really high resolution. So That to me kind of captures one of the things I think is interesting about the robotics is the ability to deploy these systems and to have them do tasks that you really couldn't do with a human being by themselves. Okay, that's where the city was. If you ever get a chance to check it out, it's actually really cool. It's full of RVs of German tourists that are not there for the city, but just there to hang out on the beach. They have really nice Greek food. Travels, we work on sort of optical camera systems for deployment underwater. And so this is a vehicle run out of the University of Rhode Island. And they were doing inspections of shipwrecks off the southern coast of Turkey. And so this is a set of amphoras. So these are clay pots that would hold wine or grain. And so this is hundreds of them that sank in the bottom of the ship. And this is a couple thousand years ago. And the idea is that obviously the wood gets dissolved by bacteria and other things in the water, but these clay pots are left. And so part of, again, what I was interested in from a robotic perspective is we're able to produce, this is a 3D map of that same environment, but with the optical imagery and that 3D map, you get this really, really high resolution information, right? So you can see an individual little starfish and the actual ridges on those pots, but again, at a depth that we wouldn't be able to do with human divers. You get to do lots of diving and hanging out with robots in the water, which is pretty fun. And so we did a lot of focus, not just on building robotic systems, but building sensor packages that then you can use to aid human divers in what they want to do. So this is a diver rig that has LED flashes, a set of stereo cameras facing down, GPS when it's at the surface, GPS doesn't work in the water, with the goal of augmenting or aiding humans that want to go, you know, record a dive site, but do that with kind of metric accuracy. This is the Sentry vehicle. This is built out of Woods Hole, a couple hours outside of Boston. And we worked to develop that camera system that you see down there. And again, this is deep water camera housing. You bring all your own illumination. So these are LEDs that go into the LED puck. And then this is the deep water camera housing. But that housing has two cutouts for the lenses, but needs to be able to withstand the pressure of a couple thousand meters. And so you end up building them out of these long machine steel blocks. The sort of goal of those projects and that vehicle you saw there is to do future exploration in the context of what NASA wants to do in space moving forward. So what you see here, these are bacterial mounds caused by sort of bacterial upwelling from the production of sort of gases out of the processing of biological life. Anyways, the goal from a robotic perspective is, can we drive that system around here, localize it, and then produce a 3D reconstruction that uses the information coming from it to get this sort of large scale relief. And so what you're gonna see here is that, you know, we both get the 3D information, so this is the 3D information of that, but also obviously the visual texture from it. Great. This is another one from that same project. This is about 600 or 700 meters underwater, so far deeper than you could go safely with humans. But again, look at these bacterial mats. And trying to work to understand how do we contextualize those in 3D, how do we understand the 3D structure of where all these are in the environment, with the hope of aiding scientists for them studying, I guess, the processes by which these are happening. The long-term goal of these projects, and this is sort of a, you know, decades-long goal, is to build the autonomy into these systems to discover biological life, and then use those same proxies on other planets, right, where you don't have high bandwidth communication like you would in air or on land. You don't have access to actually fixing the vehicle or bringing it back to some, you know, mothership. And so all of those sort of challenges of working at 700, 800 meters underwater are really very parallel to what you would see in sort of longest space exploration. And so our hope is to be able to build systems like this that do a lot in our oceans to help understand those, but also in the larger context, expand that to understand the greater universe. And I always like these images because I think they actually do look a bit like space, but this is off the West Coast, continental shelf of the United States, actually, at about 800 meters deep. Great. Okay, so the other big set of projects that I've worked on is around self-driving cars. And so I think that that also is sort of this real sense of the future of exploration. You know, this is an image of, I think, the sort of concept that gets people inspired about self-driving cars, the idea that you can sleep in the back of your car or play games or do whatever you want. Now, the reality of where we are and how far we have to go to where we want to be is actually much greater than I think we would have hoped for, but, you know, this is sort of that vision. But I like to talk about the history of this because I think it's much longer than people realize. You know, we've been building these systems in the scientific community for at least 50 years. So this is an RCA project in the 1960s where they installed metal cables into the road and used those metal cables to be able to control the steering. And then the operator there was controlling the throttle. But so there's this long, rich history of academic projects starting back then, but with this arc of increasing complexity of the sensors and the sensor systems. So two big projects, one was the ALV project and the other was VOMORS. Those were sort of in the early 80s. Here at CMU, the NavLab project, and in fact, my dean, Marshall Hubert, was one of the first people to work on the three laser scanners that went into the NavLab project, so that went from NavLab 1 to 5. But I'll highlight NavLab 5 here, and that was in the early 90s. And that project, you know, went all the way from Pittsburgh to California, like 95, 96% autonomously. And so why I like to highlight this is that sort of this technology or that sort of approach is really what you would consider very similar to what we're doing now in like a GM Super Cruise or a Tesla Autopilot. And so it took from one experimental demonstration of it in the 90s to today, and it still now kind of works commercially, right? Kind of works commercially. And so kind of giving people this sense of this sort of really long arc, but this kind of fundamental research work that was being done at research universities takes 20 or 30 years to percolate through to commercial applicability. I jump on the scene here in the early 2000s, so that's the first vehicle that I worked on, that Sandstorm. That was part of the DARPA Grand Challenge. The first one, 2004, was a desert race from LA to Vegas, actually from Barstow to Prim, to be precise, on the West Coast, but with the goal of having it traverse these off-road, 150 miles off-road, no driver, and a remote e-stop to be able to bring it to a stop. The scenarios, we went 7 miles and then flipped over, which was quite sad. And then the next year, Stanford won. And then the year after that, CMU won, and in 2007. And the Urban Challenge, which is much closer to what we do now in autonomous driving, with that vehicle Boss. That's a young me. This is an old me. So I don't know. Don't do this if you would like to maintain your youth and vigor. Find something else that is less draining. But I used to be happy. And now I am not. So, you know, think about that. That was the vehicle. But why I like to highlight this is many of these sensors are the ones that we use today. So this is a millimeter wave radar that can miniaturize and now sits on autonomous vehicles. These are LIDARs here. That's a big spinner LIDAR there. Those are camera systems very similar to what we have today. But essentially the sort of arc here is taking those sensors and making them more automotive grade and then integrating them into the vehicles. We rolled our vehicle a week before the race. It was very devastating. I think to some degree that limited our ability to be successful in that first year. And then that was the Stanford vehicle that won the next year. And that's the CMU vehicle that won the year after. But you can see this LiDAR there is beginning to look like the ones that you would see on modern self-driving cars. This is the vehicle I worked on in Michigan. And you can see it's much closer to production vehicle with just a few spinning mirror LiDARs on the roof. Is that a question or no? Fair enough. Okay, so the question you may be asking is like, well, why do we not have self-driving cars now? And I would pose there's like a reason why this is a really, really hard problem. So this is the number of fatalities per 100 million vehicle miles traveled. Let me give you a sense of perspective. You, everyone in your family, probably everyone in front of your family, collectively will not drive 100 million vehicle miles in your entire life. So that's actually a fairly significant distance. And this is the number of fatalities since 1920 to basically today. And we're down here at roughly one fatality per 100 million vehicle miles traveled. Now, not to undersell the significance and impact of auto fatalities, it's a huge killer of particularly young people. But the challenge is that we actually, as humans, aggregately are reasonably good at driving. And so to get to a point where we would have a system that's safer than this is actually a major challenge. So to some degree, we're hitting this asymptote now where we're getting to the point where, yeah, we can build systems that can do it and they fail at some certain rate. But to get it to fail at a rate that's better than that is one of these massive challenges. And to put this in perspective, until a couple of years ago, the total number of vehicle miles traveled by every self-driving car company in aggregate was an order of 5 or 10 million. Now we're probably closer to 40 or 50 million if you added everybody together, but that's still half what one fatality on average would be expected. How did it get so good? Well, we actually added lots of things that make a ton of sense. Mass adoption of traffic lights, water speed limits, seatbelts, air belts, ABS, possibility control. And those are all things that have improved the safety of vehicles. Yes. Okay, so I've been talking for 12 to 15 minutes. We have not talked about deep learning. Your question may be, how is deep learning relevant to any of this? Why are you rambling incoherently at me? So deep learning, hopefully we've done some discussion of deep learning to date. I'll use some very simple canonical examples, right? You have an image and you want to say that's a frog and that's a bird or that's a person and that's a flower pot and that's a drill, great. How much deep learning has been covered to date in this class? Not a ton, a little bit, some. Okay, well, either this will be very tutorial or will make no sense either way. So how do we do this typically, right? We have some training data, we run it through some weights, we take the error from those weights and then backpropagate that to adjust those weights to get better labeling data. This is all a fixed corpus of images that we have typically offline. So we've labeled lots of images of cars, buses, trucks, and motorcycles. And then at inference time, I get an image I've never seen before. I pass it through those same set of weights that have been trained through this process, and it produces some detection in real time that hopefully is correct. So in this example, you would hope that it says that's a person, that's a car, that's a helmet, that's a motorcycle, that's a car. Great. We've gotten even better at this as we move on. Now we can do things like this. This is an image from the KID data set, which is a German data set for self-driving. And we get to labels that like this. These are all pixels of cars. This is all pixel of road. This is pixel of grass. And so we can have inference networks that produce results that tell us things like this. So I can show an image like this that it's never seen before, and it'll tell me all these are car, that's a bicyclist, that's a road, that's grass, et cetera. So hopefully that's, you know, generally seems like that would head in the right direction of having an AI system that could help us drive. But one of the big challenges, and I think to date, is that these systems were trained on this concept of a corpus of images that are fixed. And so the sort of canonical example of that is ImageNet. That's a big data set that has 10 million different types of images or different labels, everything from, I don't know, laptop to table to dog to cat to chair to et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They're driving specific ones as well, but they're all fixed corpuses of data, right? They're like a fixed thing. I've paid some people millions of dollars to sit there and manually label lots of images over and over and over again. And then I have that and I can train networks to get really, really good at solving that problem. And that tends to generalize far better than anything we've had before. And so it's also really good at solving novel images that we presented. So I can present a new image and it'll say chair, it'll say dog, it'll say cat, it'll say whatever. The challenge is that robotic systems, like the ones we're talking about here, these are all various underwater systems. Those are your friendly self-driving cars. Those are systems that are dynamic, right? They exist in a variety of different lighting conditions. They exist in a variety of different temporal conditions. They exist and make decisions through time. And we don't really have a parallel like for computer vision for these type of dynamic systems. Take even cars, right? We have tons of car-specific data sets where we looked at many examples of different things from cars, but it is not a closed-loop system. I don't recognize the thing, make a decision, and then get fed back information about the decision I make in real time. And so the kind of resulting challenge of that has been that we've had to produce these systems and spend lots and lots of money on getting mileage to test them. So we produce some trained set of detectors, and then we deploy them and drive for tens, if not hundreds of millions of miles. And that's sort of the premise, but the challenge is it is very, very difficult to figure out how to scale that up and how to scale up a dynamic system like that. Yeah. Okay. So if we don't want to label everything, what are sort of some deep learning approaches that I think are interesting to kind of get us out of that local minimum? Well, some of these are self-supervised and unsupervised learning approaches, so ways of doing this without labeled data. I think another approach is physics, using the physics of the known universe to govern what we expect to happen and have those labels applied. And then simulation is another piece of that. So let me focus on that last one here for a second. So I think the premise of this research was, can simulation give us good training data for deep learning? And so what we did is we took Grand Theft Auto 5 and then we hacked the source engine of it and used that to produce images of driving, nominal driving scenes under a variety of light conditions, right? So this is, different VTA 5, and you can change and vary the lighting conditions and other things, but you can also produce training data like the data I showed you before, which has pixel level labels across all of those images, right? So this is a depth map. This reflects the depth of every single pixel in the scene. This is a label map, which has individual pixel labels for every single person, every single car, every single other thing. And then the question was, or the sort of hypothesis was, that we could use this to train deep learning maps to then test on real data. So you can see here's a GTA 5 image, and then here the bounding box is kicked out by the system. So this is all training data, not inference time. But you can see that, this is like, these are very challenging scenes, right? So if we can get good at recognizing things under these scenes, these actually start to look pretty good when it comes to real data. So what you'll see up here on the top, this is a real image detector trained on some other data from Germany. This is cityscapes data. So it's not what it was trained on different data from Germany. And then this is trained on 200,000 simulated images. So there are a number of false positives there. It's missing a number of cars. It's also adding another number of cars that don't exist. And just using purely simulated data, we actually did fairly well on detecting cars. If we look at that in aggregate, as we went from 10,000, 50,000, 200,000 to 500,000 simulated images, we saw strict improvement in that. And so one of the questions is where are the limits of that and how do we? Question on timing. I'm supposed to end
10 minutes.
In 10 minutes. Amazing. Okay. We're going to skip this little one here. No, actually we'll do it. Okay, so until myself driving car research, this is Ming Yuan. He's a graduate student who recently graduated with me at the University of Michigan. You'll see he's driving up to a crossway street here, and he knows he needs to slow down, edge out a little bit, look left and right to figure out if that road is clear. Now, that's a very intuitive human behavior, right? I don't want to get hit, so I got to edge out and do that. That's a very difficult behavior to model for self-driving cars. How do we teach a self-driving car that is a safe way of approaching a scenario without having to hand code lots of examples of it? So he thought a lot about risk assessment and planning. And so if you can quantify the risk to the vehicle, perhaps we can use that to make control decisions that make the vehicle safer. Okay, so we're this blue car here. We want to make this left turn here to end up here at that yellow star. And this is a red car that could run into us. So the green that you see here is the field of view of the sensors. That's what I can see. And you'll notice, right, I can't see behind that car, obviously, because it's blocking my view. And I also can't see around corners, right? So the building is also blocking my view. More importantly, given some assumptions about friction and things we know about the environment, we can say that, well, in the next second and a half, these are the possible locations the blue car, me, can end up. And these are the possible locations the red car can end up under the assumption that it's going to drive within some margin of the speed limit and in the correct direction of traffic in that lane, right? Great. Well, what if there's a car over here that's just outside the view of where I can see right now? What we were looking to do is, can we quantify that, understand it, and then think about all of the possible scenarios probabilistically that exist outside of where I can see right now. And understanding those and quantifying that gives me a sense of risk at this intersection. Okay, so there could be a car over here in that lane of traffic, and it could be anywhere here in the next second and a half. And there could be a car over here that I can't see, and it could be anywhere here. But what that shows you is that, well, only this area here is at risk of me colliding with something that I can't see. And I know this car is only gonna be here, so that's also gonna be safe. And this is the notion of forward reachable sets. So those blue areas are the forward reachable set of my ego vehicle, and those red areas are the forward reachable set of other vehicles in the scenario. So you can treat this like a particle filter or a bunch of other things, but what that means essentially is each of those red dots represents one probable future that could exist at some time step in the future. And if we begin to think about aggregating those, we can think about all kinds of different types of intersections. This is just a standard four-way stop. Here's where the geometry is slightly different. Here's the geometry slightly different as well. What that allows us to do is to quantify the risk and then to make control decisions that minimize that risk to get us to some new location safely. So you can see the vehicle's proceeding here, and you can see all of this, and it wants to turn left here, or there, or there, or there. But if you think about that on aggregate, this is a overall map of Ann Arbor, where we did a lot of this research. And we can go from collision rates of 0 up to 5 as a percentage. And we can think about what is the safety of any intersection around that city based on the geometry of that city and the configuration of my sensors. So let me do two things. lets me plan routes that minimize going through really risky intersections. And it also lets me move my sensors around to try to maximize the visibility through those intersections without ever having to drive any of them beforehand, just using the physical geometry that we have there. Okay, I got like 5 minutes, yeah? Amazing. Okay, so last thing I'm gonna tell you about, and I'm gonna tell you how I became a professor. Underwater manipulation. This is Gideon. He is now graduated and just graduated recently. And he was really interested in this problem. He wants to figure out how do we, this is being done by a human right now. They're taking a soil sample. This is down 700 meters underwater. So obviously not safe for humans. Let's take a soil sample and then put it back in the sample tray, right? And so you've already made a ton of mistakes. You should have been an ROV driver. They're paid a ton of money. It requires some specific training, but no college degree. And they get paid more than any of us will ever get paid from now to forever because it's this very highly skilled and very, very difficult job. So one of the goals is, can we develop robotic systems to make them both safer, but also to decrease the cost of this to allow science to be done more ubiquitously? Great. So he worked on a bunch of systems here, but he produced some ground truth data so that we could validate this whole study by putting fiducials, those little markers, all over all of those various T handles. And then he wanted to understand, okay, well, can I map the environment and then make sure that I'm constantly recognizing this? And these aren't used for recognizing, these are just used for ground truth. So this is that arm moving around with a fairly wide field of view lens. And you can see here, this is in ROS, but he is detecting both the position of the arm and the positions of other T handles related to that. And then you can see here, this is the projection of a 3D model of those as the ego motion moves around. And it's trying to figure out where the T handles are so they can then grasp and closely manipulate. Okay, so that's sort of the beginning of that. Oh, sorry. This is his system. Oh, no. This is his system detecting both the angle and the translation of each of these poses in real time. Okay, so then he wanted to close the loop on that. So we did a bunch of test setups here in this sand pool. This is the final system that I've deployed on. There's a wrist-mounted fisheye lens. There's a vehicle-mounted stereo camera. And he wants to do both 3D reconstruction in real time from those stereo cameras, detection of the T-handles in real time, and then closed-loop grasp manipulation. So here's what it looks like. This is again in ROS, him making a plan to grab one of the handles and put it into the new position, and ultimately making those decisions and then having a single button to execute the closed loop performance of that task. And the goal here was to kind of move to a language driven system where you could say, pick up the T handle and place it back in the tray. We'd understand that natural language and then translate that directly into robotic operations. He did some field operations with it. This is a real-time 3D reconstruction. I'm trying to grab things there. You can see the challenges of working underwater. There's a lot of noise, a lot of particulates in the water. And then here's sort of everything coming together. So this is soil down really deep in the water, and he's trying to slip it up with that gun. And then it's the real-time reflection of that on the 3D model of that big ROV. Here's it with natural language. Go to the sample location. Natural language is turned into a set of primitives. Those primitives are then executed here through that ROS system where it makes those decisions about where to end up. Okay, I have 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Amazing. I will tell you about the entirety of the course of my life in the next 2 minutes.
Yeah, this is one of the most important parts.
Okay, so how I ended up as a professor. So this is me. So the first thing I'll say is, like, if you want advice on how to be successful in your career, which often people come to me and ask, I provide a random string of numbers because I would say that that is the level at which you should take advice from any people as useful to your own life. I played these numbers and won a lottery. Maybe you can play those numbers and win a lottery. Maybe you won't. I don't totally know. This worked for me. I would say it's very similar to bingo in that I am not sure that advice you get from anyone is terribly useful for your own lives. The context in which you're going to college, grad school, possibly becoming professors is different even than me, and I'm not even that old. And it's and the advice that I received when I was trying to become a professor was super not useful because things have changed so significantly in the intervening 10 years. I went to college in 2001, that's when I started. And going to college now is incredibly different in terms of getting in terms of what high school experience looks like, in terms of all those things. So, you know, I don't know, play some numbers. Maybe you'll win. This guy from Fox News has amazing advice. How do you increase the chance of winning the lottery? Buy as many tickets as you can afford. Solid financial advice. Get this guy on Squawk Box. But the reality is, I do think there's something to this. Not a lot of the thing. That's a terrible idea. That's a tax on people who don't understand probability. But the idea that the maximization of the opportunities you have to end up in the career you want, end up where you want to go, take as many as you can, take as many chances as you can, try as many things as you can. Doing something like this is a great opportunity as an example, but you know, just take a lot and some are gonna pay off. Because I don't think any of the ones that I did, I knew were gonna pay off. So that was me, I was here, I was young, I was happy, I got old. I finished undergrad here and I thought, I gotta get out of here. Had enough of CMU, so I tried to go as far as possible away. So I looked on the map, and Sydney, Australia was as far as humanly possible, it seemed. And so I just left. I thought, I'd get out of here, kangaroo with a teddy bear. But I got to work on these really cool systems that I never had an opportunity to do here. So this is underwater robots, and it was so different than what I was doing here with self-driving cars. And that kind of changed the whole direction of my research. I then went from there, and was trying to finish my thesis, and I lived in London for a while, and then moved in with a woman in France. So I moved down here, and I was living in Paris for a while, and then I thought, oh man, I probably need to finish my PhD, or it's gonna be bad, so I moved back to Sydney to finish. I was then there for a while, I finished my PhD finally, come back to that, it was pretty terrible, and then I thought, let me get out of here. I felt like a more European gentlemen, I felt like I had more European sensibility, you know. I enjoyed wine, the finer things. And I thought that just nobody understood me. And so I thought Europe is going to be the spot. I moved to Sweden, and like the IKEA manual that you receive, very difficult to interpret. I really struggled in Sweden. Sweden was tough. Life-wise, very dark, which they don't tell you. Beautiful in summer, very grim in the winter. But I got to work on different humanoid robots. It was an incredible experience from an academic perspective, but it was so different than what I was doing before. I thought maybe humanoids was the future. I was wrong. I came to Boston for the world's shortest postdoc. I was there for 3 weeks, realized it was a huge mistake, and quit. And then I came back to Sydney. When I was back in Sydney, I came back for one of Australia's largest housing crises. I had nowhere to live. I slept under my desk. It was not me. Slept under my desk for 3 months, and I would hide out from security guards. Hopefully, if this is recorded, they don't know. I would hide out from security guards. And the motion sensors, if you ever want to know this, motion sensors tend to get triggered when things roll over at night. So if you leave at like 11:55, the motion sensors will rearm if you come back in at 1, if you ever want to break into 11. That was pretty grim. I then took a job in Ann Arbor, which was pretty hard as well. I thought, great, Great Lakes. I do underwater research. That's great. I got to Ann Arbor and then didn't realize it's completely landlocked. It's not near any water at all. That's Ann Arbor. That's the closest water away, over 2 hours. And all of that experience, and I'm really underselling how hellish it was, it ends up with 1, 2, 3 lines. That is it. You don't even get ranges on oftentimes, you just get the termination dates. And that is what like that entire lived experience is captured at. So in some ways, maybe that's grim, but in other ways, it suggests that you can have a lot of sets of experiences and move on to do new things without it being every single thing being critically important if it doesn't go great. Because it turns into 3 lines on your CV and no one tells you that. No one told me that ever. I then moved from there to here pretty recently. Yes, I will stop there because this, not everyone here is trying to become a professor. I will save the job market stuff for later. I'm going to pause there and see if there are any questions. Thanks.
Hi, everyone. We're going to kick off the Q&A session with an online question. The question is, what are some open problems / research areas that remain in autonomous vehicle planning and control?
Yes, so I would say that the biggest sort of open-ended problems in planning and control is probably quantification of uncertainty, particularly in the perception system. So to like on risk-aware planning and planning with guarantees. But the challenge with that is you have to know how uncertain you are about other things in the world. uncertainty around your own pose is actually pretty well quantified. SLAM localization techniques do a good job of quantifying that probabilistically. But if I think there's a car over there, and I'm like pretty sure there's a car over there, and I think it's at, you know, position 20 by 5 by 2, quantifying how uncertain I am about that, I think is a very challenging problem. And so most of the work that I see in sort of risk-aware planning or guarantee planning lacks the ability to have that interface between perception and control in such a way to make those systems safe. Hopefully that answers that. Risk-aware planning is a big section. Learning-based planning approaches that attempt to solve more complex planning problems as deep learning problems has been pretty interesting. Thanks.
We will now take a question from the room. So Chugos, if you want to just stand up and.
Oh, okay. Question. So I worked in the NAB lab last summer, and this summer I'm working in Autonomous Lab on data. My question is, what does it seem that like doctors, like cars are held to higher standards than doctors are?
In terms of like killing people?
Yeah.
This is a more complex question. I think it comes down to like the systems at play there. So, and this is like, we're way outside my wheelhouse, but I'm gonna give you like my two cents. This is Matt's unendorsed two cents on this. So my partner, she's a doctor. And so doctors are not machines. They're humans who require a lot of training, and we then hope they perform at a pretty high level, and we put some guardrails on that. So like if you kill a bunch of people, you kind of notice it, and then we try to fire you. But even really that doesn't happen. So there are, and this will horrify you if you ever have to go to a hospital, but there are really good doctors and there are really bad doctors statistically. If I were to look at the data, really good, really bad. Outcomes, really good, really bad. Some of that is confounded by how sick your patients are. And so more talented doctors tend to end up with sicker patients because they are better. But all of that to say that they're these very imperfect human systems. And so we don't have a good way of really assessing how good or bad they are. Automotive systems, completely different. They get mass produced. And the principal reason why I think the standards are much higher is under mass production, it's much easier to get aggregate statistics on how well a system works, right? So if I have 100,000 of the same fuel pump and 10 of them explode, that actually is fine under our current rules. But if like 500 of them explode, that's too many. And so the power, we have to reason about that and the repeatability of that. We know that we should be able to produce ones that have this sort of error bounds. We don't have that with humans. And so we do the best we can, which is we make you go through 10 years of training, and then we hope that you're a good doctor as a consequence of that. But two hospitals that are right next to each other can have dramatically different outcomes with the same incoming population. And we know that's the case. We have studies that show that, and we have no way to fix it. Also, doctors' unions are very strong, and so they hopefully that we can talk offline though, because I have a lot of thoughts on doctors. Sorry, question.
Connor will.
Yes.
All right, we have another question. They say, thank you very much, Dr. Johnson Robertson, for your presentation. How do you deal with bad weather conditions for autonomous cars? Fog, rain, snow, water on the lens, et cetera.
That's a great question. So I think much of the academic research that's going on right now is really around that. If you look at where full-size self-driving cars are tested, primarily Southern California, Arizona, some work now in Miami and a few other places. But the upshot of that is this real focus on warm weather, no weather driving. So the big challenges are LIDAR returns hit particulates in the water or in the air. So things like snow or rain and don't come back to the sensor. So you lose all your range measurements there. Cameras are obviously obscured by rain and snow. All these are sort of open challenges. So ways around this is that people train on data that has have those conditions in it. So for visual systems, while cars obscured by rain are harder, if I have 10 million examples of that, I can actually do a pretty good job. And it's the same for night driving and a few other things. But that doesn't get you around the problem where you have total obscurance that are just blocking everything you can see. That's an open problem. One of the things that gets you around that, radar. So radar obviously operates in the electromagnetic spectrum at a place that is much less susceptible to things like rain or snow or fog. So radars are useful. They're lower resolution, harder to interpret, and generally just sort of less understood sensors or less simplistic sensors than those other ones. And so have some associated challenges, but those are sort of coarsely the way we're trying to deal with it. There tends to be a lot of redundancy in those sensors, LiDAR, camera, radar. And so using sensor fusion to try to do all of those things at the same time is one of the ways around that, if that makes sense.
I actually have a question. Please. So you were talking about how you can predict vehicle movements and people are generally trained, you know, we learn how to drive, so you learn, but pedestrians are a little bit different in regards to predictability. So how do you train an autonomous vehicle to predict an unpredictable human, basically?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So there's a bunch of work, and that's on my group and elsewhere, where we take a bunch of existing data of pedestrians, and we look into, we try to understand and predict where they're going to go. Some of that's probabilistic, so we say, in the next 2 seconds, these are all the locations that person could probably go. But to get to the core of perhaps what you're getting at, to functionally drive, you have to make certain assumptions of what others are going to do. And one of those assumptions is that if I'm driving next to a sidewalk, I have to assume people are not going to step off. And that's sort of one of the more challenging fundamental assumptions, because if someone does blindly step off the sidewalk, you would not be able to drive if you assumed that every human that could enter your travel path will. And so you have to make some bets. And I think fundamentally what that really gets at is you struggle to talk about the ethics and the reasoning around how we want to drive in such a scenario. Because you as a human can also make that assumption, right? Like, if you were to go only 5 miles an hour, we would have no like step off the curb pedestrian fatalities, but you don't. You just assume that people aren't going to do it and you try to react to them. The only positive news on that front is that the electronic systems react faster than we would. So humans introduce anywhere from 100 to more realistically half a second of latency. So I see somebody, I know they're stepping off the sidewalk, I decide, oh no, I have to stop. And then I move my foot to actuate. That loop tends to be almost half a second in many cases. An electronic system can be much faster than that. It can be as fast as sort of 10, 15 milliseconds. So that helps. But fundamentally, there's a lot of work on this, but the biggest sort of open problem is, how do you reason probabilistically about what people are going to do, because they're unpredictable as you have it. But we have some really nice models that exist in the community where you can kind of capture that. You can say there's a 1% chance someone's going to step off, and that's probably pretty unlikely. But some of the work we do for that is you look at the alignment of the shoulders. It's very difficult to walk in a way that your shoulders aren't aligned to, but you can do that, but you typically wouldn't. So the biomechanism has part of that. So we look at that, pose, head motion, where your hands are. To build a model. Yeah. If that helps. Oh, wait, what are we doing on the line? So I'll come back to you.
Connor, do you have a question on there? Or?
Yeah. So, what, if any, recent advances are you excited about in stereo vision, computer vision, autonomous driving, or manipulation? It's a pretty open question.
Everything. Things I'm really excited about is that I just showed some kind of preliminary work in simulation where we're using video game engines. That's advanced quite a bit. So in the last year or so, there are now sort of much more visually realistic, high fidelity visual simulators. And I think that's pretty exciting. In stereo, I would say, so I'm classically working in stereo vision, monocular depth estimation has progressed significantly. So because of deep learning, stereo vision, quick stereo vision lesson, I have a left eye, I have a right eye, I measure the shift in where one edge ends in one eye and then it's in the other, and that difference you can triangulate to figure out how far away something is. Monocular vision relies on other cues, shading, depth, what the thing is, to figure out how far away something is. And as a consequence of that, it's advanced significantly in the last 5 years. So we're approaching being able to, with a monocular camera, do what we're doing with stereo. And that's incredibly exciting. So that's probably the thing I'm most excited about in that domain. I would highly encourage you to go check out where monocular vision is in driving.
Thank you.
One else in the front had a bit. I was wondering how you controlled the depth when you were doing like the underwater exploration with them being like that heavy. How did you keep it from just going right to the bottom?
That's a great question. So when you build those systems, one of the things we're really focused on is creating neutral buoyancy. And so what we want is ideally to be slightly positively buoyant, so that if it completely lost control authority, so the batteries die, motors fail, it will slowly float to surface. Now, 4,000 meters, that would be like a week probably to get back to surface. It's not super useful because it's been drifting in the interim. But at 500 meters, if you have enough positively buoyant, it'll go up. There are two safety mechanisms you also have in there. We use a thing called a corrodible link, which is made out of a metal that corrodes at a known rate. And that link, as soon as it hits salt water, begins to corrode. And then when it finishes corroding, we have weights that are attached to it that drop off, dramatically increasing the buoyancy. But perhaps the most fundamental question you're asking is, like, how do you keep it from falling to the bottom? The thing is made out of metal, but we also put on things there that are voluminous, but not heavy. And so what that actually in practice on those systems is usually syntactic foam. Syntactic foam is made out of little microbubbles, like glass little microbubbles. And what that means is it takes up a lot of volume, but it's incredibly not dense. And so, you know, to get to neutral buoyancy or to positive buoyancy, you just need things that are less dense than water so that they'll float up. So that thing in air is, I don't know, 400 kilos. In water, it is neutral. So it's basically weighs nothing, right? Or in fact, is positively weighted. So it's a negative against the force of gravity. Yeah. Force of not force of gravity, but yeah, hope that helps.
Oh, yeah. Do you want to go? Can we get our
knob
on the last one to do a
chapter
three?
Yeah.
So, do you
want to?
Yes.
Yeah. So, it's similar to our question.
Yeah.
In terms of worst case scenario, how do you say, okay, the system should behave in this way? It's like the trolley question, essentially. Mm-hmm. Which, how do you program it to be like, okay, in the worst case scenario, do you save the passengers or the quote-unquote pedestrians,
yeah,
or anybody else?
Great question. My answer, like, to the sort of more general trolley question problem is, like, right now, we crash into the passengers, catch on fire, and kill everyone in the compartment. So, like, we solve none of the problems, right? So the challenge, I think, is that the level of sophistication to be able to make those decisions, I think, is sort of well beyond where we are. Now, not to be overly pessimistic, there's an answer here about, well, I realize there's no safe trajectory that doesn't intersect with an obstacle if I continue on that. And in that scenario, really the way it works in practice is we would tend to decelerate as quickly as we possibly could. And so the reality is, like, you can come up with much more complicated and elaborate schemes. But all of those, so I can imagine I'm going to swerve, I'm going to do X, I'm going to do Y, I'm going to do Z. All of those make a set of assumptions that are probably much harder to validate. Probably, and this is not like always true, but in more cases than not, decelerating as fast as possible, even if you get hit from behind, is going to be the safest because you reduce the kinetic energy of that vehicle. And so if you do run into somebody or you run into something else or you run into a wall with less kinetic energy, there's less likelihood that people inside get hurt or whoever you're running into gets hurt. So the what to get you kind of to an algorithm, you're constantly looking for a safe trajectory that keeps within where you know you're allowed to drive. And if you lose all of those, you decelerate as quickly as possible, typically. There's some caveats to that, but that captures most of what modern cars do.
Will.
Yeah,
Will.
Thank you for the presentation. In terms of your life experience, you've been to a lot of places in the DevOps. Can I ask what were your guiding principles as you're going through that? Sort of those same spots that you're trying to
filter those opportunities? Flailing around without a plan is how I would describe it. So it's a great question. I was trying with each of those things to optimize for different parts of my life. I assumed that, particularly early on, there would be a great benefit to a radically different environment with radically different experiences than I was having currently, just to get another data point to try to figure out a gradient of what I wanted to do, right? And I don't know if I'd recommend this as generalized strategy because you end up bouncing off a lot of things, but I didn't really have a rudder. Like, I didn't know what I wanted to do. And so the answer was, we'll do the opposite of what I'm doing now and see if that sucks more or less, and then the opposite of that again, and the opposite of that again, and the opposite of that again. And there was also this other big fundamental shift that kind of I bounced between. One was optimizing for life. So Pittsburgh in the early 2000s didn't have a lot going on. It was a lot quieter in the city than now. Sydney was like an international cosmopolitan city. And so I was like, let's go check that out. And it really was. It had all the things I wanted. It had much nicer restaurants and museums and plays and movies and whatever. And I thought, I spent all of undergrad here. focus exclusively on academics, and I felt like I had not lived fully. And then I got to Australia, and man, I was living a lot. And then, you know, so I needed to oscillate back. And so that move to Ann Arbor was the oscillation in the other direction. It was to oscillate to say, oh, I want a tenure track job, and I wasn't gonna get it in Sydney, so let me go do that. And I ended up being great at, and but the other thing that I think I couldn't have anticipated is that like my desires and wants evolved over time as well. So I think you feel like you're gonna be static, like whatever I want now, I want in 5 years, so I should do whatever I want now. And I think I greatly discounted how much of what I would want would change as I age. And I think that the only constant is that I was so not the same person I was when I was 21, when I was 25, 30, or 35, now. And always acknowledging that allowed me to make sure that I would change course as I change. And I think without that, I would have stayed on the same track, which would have been, you know, less useful.
One more prior nod.
Yeah, thank you for entertaining and my question was, so during the slides, you pulled up a graph with the, I guess, number of auto fatalities.
Yeah.
And you said how like humans nowadays have set a pretty high standard for what autonomous vehicles have to do in terms of auto fatalities. But in terms of, instead of like failing less, is there, I guess, a lower threshold for failing more gracefully in terms of having autonomous vehicles have less severe car accidents?
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And yes, totally. So one of the things that I was getting at there is that in all of that sort of descending fatalities that come from these additional safety systems, one of the biggest takeaways that I have in the AV space is that much of the technology we're developing is beginning to filter onto vehicles. And this driving down of the cost curve of LiDARs and other things will produce safety systems that are far superior to what we have now. And even if we don't get to level 3 vehicles or level 4 vehicles that you can sleep in the back of, I believe that much of the stuff that's being worked on now will dramatically reduce fatality rates there, to your point, make those cars safer on their own. And then the question is there a point where we want to let people sleep in cars? And I think probably yes. And I don't think you even necessarily need, it's not clear where that breakpoint is. And this is a much more interesting societal question. If the system was 10% less safe than humans, but it was uniformly distributed, because right now, what's not captured in that graph is those fatalities are not being distributed. Old drivers, young drivers, new drivers, impaired drivers, distracted drivers, those are the fatalities cluster, right? And so right now, if I look at on average, yeah, it's one, but if you took a driver that's 17, that number is much, much higher as a percentage of those. So that's a question I don't have the answer to. I don't think any of us can individually do. As a society, we have to decide, would it be better to make all 17-year-old drivers use an autonomous system simply because I would say, if you ask me based on like data we have about general public safety and like what we think people should be doing, my guess is that we're going to err probably on the side of giving more autonomy to humans, letting them do whatever they want, even if it's less safer than the autonomous system, because we tend to discount. We have a pretty bad prior in that, like, we think we're really good at everything, like, as an individual, and we make decisions based on that, regardless of whether or not that's true. So, like, I think I'm a great driver, so, like, I should be allowed to drive, even if I'm not a great driver, or on aggregate, we aren't. And so, because of the way I think that human fallacy works, we're probably going to trend towards saying, let us do it until the cars are so much safer that it's, like, compellingly bad to do it, or the financial model of it is so much cheaper that you're just going to do it for Uber and things like that. Right? Okay, and now I ran over. I'm sorry. Thank you all so much. I'm going to do anything here.
Yeah. So this will conclude today's Rebel Launch session. Thank you so much for your talk.